It's not always easy, and sometimes life can be deceiving. I'll tell you one thing, it's always better when we're together. It's always better when we're together. Yeah, we'll look at them stars when we're together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. Moments just might find their way into my dreams tonight, but I know that they'll be gone when the morning light sings or brings new things. For tomorrow night you see that they'll be gone too. Too many things I have to do, but if all of these dreams might find their way into my day-to-day scene, I'd be under the impression I was somewhere in between, with only two, just me and you. Not so many things we got to do, or places we got to be. We'll sit beneath the mango tree now. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. We're somewhere in between together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. Combination of words I could say, but I will still tell you one thing, we're better together. Can't you see that it's just raining? There ain't no need to go outside. But baby, you hardly even notice when I try to show you. Song is meant to keep you doing what you're supposed to. Waking up too early, maybe we could sleep. Make you banana pancakes, pretend like it's the weekend now. Pretend it all the time. Can't you see that it's just rain? There ain't no need to go outside. But just maybe, like a ukulele, mama made a baby. Really don't mind the practice, cause you're my little lady. Lady, lady, love me, cause I love to lay you lazy. We could close the curtains, pretend like there's no world outside. Then we could pretend it all the time, Lord. And can't you see that it's just raining? There ain't no need to go outside. Ain't no need, ain't no need. Can't you see, can't you see? Rain all day and I don't mind. But the telephone's singing, ringing. it's too early, don't pick it up. We don't need to, we got everything we need right here, and everything we need is enough. Just so easy when the whole world fits inside of your arms. Do we really need to pay attention to the alarm? Wake up slow. Wake up slow.
Hello, hello everyone.
Hello. Yes.
Hi. Nice to see you. How are you doing?
Good. How are you, Dolphin?
I'm fine. I'm really excited. Really excited to be here. And I can see we have already 58 participants. This is great. So while we settle a few things, if you could maybe the participants tell us in the chat where you're from and maybe your position. That would be interesting to know a bit more about our audience.
Okay, fantastic. Let's see. Hopefully there will be a lot of responsive and excited also participants from Indonesia in here, because I believe most of them coming from Indonesia. So great. How is the weather in, are you in France or Switzerland or something?
I am in France, very close to Geneva. Like the border is about 10 minutes away. But in France, okay, in the French Alps. And the weather today is like miserable. It's raining, it's cold. It's about, I don't know, like 5 degrees out there. So there is fire in the fireplace. So what about you? How is it where you are?
Well, I am based in Jakarta, Indonesia. There is only two options in Indonesia. So either it's shiny or very shiny. Oh, there is a third option. It's raining sometimes, but it's somehow the season as well. But it's still not raining today. So it's manageable. We stay home.
Okay, well, you are lucky. A bit of sun could help here. But I mean, the fall season has been okay this year. That's fine. Mm-hmm. That's fine.
Okay, so I will just say hi and start this webinar. Just play a couple of slides about Swiss Education Group. I think the attendees in here, they're not really yet aware about the company that, the institution on which you're also coming from. So good afternoon, everyone from Indonesia. Not to forget to introduce myself as well. My name is Ronaldo Christie. I'm working as a regional manager for Indonesia and Philippines for this company, the Swiss Education Group, as we can see the logo next to me. And thanks a lot to Pamer Indonesia and FHTB. This event is organized through the collaboration with Pamer Indonesia. And I will just share my screen a little bit, just to play a couple of slides. Is it visible, Dolphin?
Yeah, well, we see your very busy desktop with a lot of open windows.
And but is it visible right now?
Yes, we can see your screen. It's working, Ronaldo. It's working. Okay.
Perfect. So I have informed a little bit in the beginning, today we have Mrs. Delphine Blangena. She is a lecturer from the Cesar College in Switzerland, on which this is an institution owned by the Swiss Education Group. As we see on the slide in here, basically the Swiss Education Group, we are the owning company for several hospitality institution, hospitality business management, as well as culinary arts institution in Switzerland. As we are the global leader in hospitality and business education, and all of our campuses are located in Switzerland. So we have the Swiss Hotel Management School, Hotel and Resort of Montreux, Cesar Ritz Colleges, Switzerland, as well as the Culinary Arts Academy. And uniquely, as I inform, all of the programs that we have in with an SEG schools, we only offer either a culinary program or business and hospitality management with different specializations. And today in particular, this virtual session is going to be delivered by Ms. Delphine from Cesar Ritz that will talk deeper and discuss the interesting topic. Technology and hospitality industry, as we know that technology has evolved in many different industries in the world, including the hospitality business industry as well. But without forgetting as well, I would like to play a short video about the Cesar Ritz Colleges Switzerland to provide you also an image and an understanding about the campus a little bit.
Whether you're working for a five-star hotel or a Fortune 500 company, world-class service is always important. At Cesar Ritz College of Switzerland, business blends seamlessly with hospitality. With teaching based on the philosophy of Cesar Ritz, considered the pioneer of luxury hospitality, our students are pillars of luxury, excellence, and service. As a bachelor's student, you will have the choice to begin your studies on the scenic lake shores of the Bouvre or in the city center of Lucerne, enjoying easy access to major European destinations and city life, before spending your third and final year up at our great campus. With a strong focus on business, study in partnership with Washington State University, and your final year will culminate in the WSU Business Plan Competition. And by sharing a campus with Culinary Arts Academy students, not only will you be learning from the king of hoteliers, you'll be dining like one too. Moving on to your master's, in partnership with the University of Derby, you will be based full-time up at our Brig campus. It's the perfect place to immerse yourself in Swiss life, enjoying everything the Alps have to offer. As proud members of Swiss Education Group, our school is part of the largest private education group in Switzerland. This is your opportunity to meet your future employer at the biannual International Recruitment Forum and become part of the largest alumni network in the industry. By studying at Cesar Ritz Colleges, you'll discover Switzerland, learn business, and live hospitality. Are you up for the challenge?
Okay, so now it's the time for Ms. Delphine to explore the topic, and I leave it the rest all of it attention and all ears for Ms. Delphine then.
Okay, hello everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I am going to share my screen immediately. While we settle that, that would be really nice if some of you, the participants, can write in the chat, in the chat, your name and maybe your organization or your current position, so that we know a bit more about the audience. That would be nice. I know you might be a bit shy, so please give it a try while I'm sharing my screen. Okay. Okay. And here we go. Okay. Good. Alors, I'm just checking the sound. Good. Can you all see my screen? It's a yellow background with technology and responsibility written on it. Ronaldo, how does it look?
Perfect.
Fantastic. Let's go. With the rain, the connection has been a bit unstable. If this glitch, I will pause and start again. This is, of course, the magic of technology. We all depend so much on the connection, but let's make it happen. So today, I want to talk to you about technology and responsibility. I'm not a techie. I'm not going to go into the details of technological aspects from a technical point of view, but from a global perspective as leaders about the future of the industry. Okay, but first let me introduce myself. As Ronaldo said a few words, so I'm French and Swiss, which means I have a terrible accent. I'm sorry about it. I'm doing my best. I'm 42 years old. Of course, I look much younger than that. I have two children. They should not show up now. Two cats, one of them might show up. I have a couple of master degrees from Oxford, London, and Berlin universities in management and economics, as well as a sustainable value creation. I have a postgrad in marketing. I am currently a lecturer for Swiss Education Group. I'm teaching business plan, marketing, and ethics. I have side activities. I have also a consulting business in the field of neuroscience. I'm deeply interested in how the brain learns, okay? And the future of jobs and the impact of technology on our brain and on our way of living. I'm also consulting for the French Ministry of Education as well as Geneva Business School. I'm a huge fan of art and the mountain by every weather. So if you ever come to Switzerland, whether in summer or in winter, mountain is fantastic. If you want to know me more about me, you have here a QR code linked to my website. I'm also on all social medias, LinkedIn. So don't hesitate to connect if you have afterthoughts or things you want to discuss after this presentation. First, I'm going to ask everyone to write in the chat, please, just a number. I want you to think, pause for a second, look at your life, okay, and count how many connected devices do you own? How many connected devices do you own? Including, of course, smartphones, connected watch, iPad, computers, video games. So how many do you have? Let's see, I see people already answering. Oh, I cannot use the chat box. Okay, but you can answer the questions. Okay, I have people answering. Three, thank you very much. Are there more people who want to tell us how many smartphones? Maybe Ronaldo, you can tell us how many,
devices? How many devices? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Four, okay. Our audience, thank you. Thank you, Subas. Anderson, and sorry if I say your name wrong. Thank you very much for your participation. So all of you are saying between 3 and 4. Actually, some statistics have been showing us that today in the US, if we take one household, on average, all the family members together have 11 connected devices, okay, including screens, TV, smartphone, and so on. This is a study from Deloitte last year. And if we look at what is going on, actually globally by force, it says that the number of active connected devices is over 30 billion. So it's a huge market and it's on the rise, okay? You currently have 3 devices. Most probably in a couple of years, you will have more than that. So it's really a market on the rise, okay? It's also interesting to see that the way we use those connected devices is impacting us very deeply. Maybe some of you are old enough to have known the world without the internet and are still surprised, okay? But the next generation will be surprised by the very few connected devices we own at the moment, because it's really rising. I've been looking into how those devices impact our brain, how we work with that. And we found out that there is a super thumb connection, actually between your thumbs and your brain, there is a new physiological, like a motorway of information. And this has been shaped by the use of smartphones. Actually, if you think about it, the way you use your smartphones, you might type with your thumbs, but if you look maybe at people who are a bit older, like your grandparents, maybe if you are lucky to have them, your great grandparents, if you are very lucky, if they use smartphones, they don't use their thumbs. They use this finger to type on it like this, because they don't have this super connection, because they started using those devices too late. We know the hand is extremely important for the brain plasticity, because the hand is actually can actually be a substitute of any sense that is missing. For example, people who are blind can read using their hands and the braille reading systems. And there has been some studies in Switzerland at the University of Zurich in the last 2 years. And they have been measuring the brain activity depending on the type of device people use. And we found out that people who use devices without touch screens don't have this connection from the thumb to the brain, okay? So the way we use technology is actually impacting the way your brain works. So what I'm saying, in other words, is that the using touchscreen reshapes your sensory process. So that's also interesting when you think of your customers, okay? Because they will interact from a sensory point of view with your brand, depending on what you show them on your devices. And that our contemporary brain continuously is shaped by your personal use of digital technology, okay? In other words, what I'm telling you is that in a few years, we might all look like this. Because one of the theories saying that actually because of this super connection from the thumb to the brain, our fingers, especially our thumb, will grow longer so that it's more appropriate for the way we have, the way we use technology, okay? So actually technology is even shaping in the future the way we will look. But Spielberg said it all in 1982 with our very cute E.T. And technology is also creating new disease. For example, there's a new name that came out. This is the iPhone tendonitis. It's when you have a pain here with your thumbs. It's a new disease. So you see, technology is not only impacting the industry. It's not only impacting how we create value and the customer experience. It's impacting all of us at the deepest of who we are, our brain. So what I would like, and this will be my main message today. Christian Louis Lange was a French scientist and he won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1921. So like 100 years ago. And he said, technology is a useful servant, but a dangerous master. Technology is a useful servant, but a dangerous master. And I think that's really summarizing very well how we should tackle technology. How can we make sure that technology is my servant to improve my life, to improve my customer experience, to improve the performance of my company, okay, but not becomes my master? And this is what we will discuss in detail today. So let me introduce you to Connie. Connie is a super, super cute, kawaii robot. It's a concierge at the Hilton. I'm sharing a video with you now. So let me see this. I'm sharing computer sound. You should be able to hear. Just see how Connie has been displayed at the Hilton hotels to enhance a better customer experience. Let's go. Okay. Loading. Ah, I don't know. It was working just before.
Maybe the connection, as you say. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Okay, let me try again. Oh yes, I think it's starting now. I was just too quick. Just loading. So as you will see, Connie is pretty small, it's about that size, okay? And it's next to the reception at most of the Hilton hotels, and it's there to deliver a different consumer experience. While it loads, I can tell you a bit more. So Connie has many very different abilities. Of course, Connie is just the device. What is interesting is the artificial intelligence behind it, okay?
Hilton, you might find Connie, a robot concierge powered by IBM's Watson artificial intelligence platform. At the Hilton McLean in Virginia, Connie is learning to interact with guests and respond to their queries. Connie can recognize and respond to questions that...
Okay. Are you still with me? Completely went blank on my screen.
Yeah, it's...
Ronaldo, can you still hear me?
Yes, I can still hear you, but it is blank, I think. Maybe there is an issue on the connection of.
Okay, that's pretty bad. I'm gonna move on. Okay, so. Okay. Okay, the video stopped. Okay. Before I move on to Sam, I'm starting with Connie. So what is interesting with Connie? Yeah, probably. I have a couple of videos. We'll see how we can manage. So Connie is actually interesting because Connie can speak as many languages as you want, which means that for a consumer that is not, for example, comfortable speaking in a foreign language, you can address to Connie in any language you want. And Connie also has the ability to adapt the vocabulary it uses to the person it is talking to. Would say that I would say that if a 5 years old with a limited vocabulary would go to Connie and say, where is the restaurant? I need to go to the bathroom. Okay, Connie would adapt the language level to the person it is talking to using very simple words. Okay, and that's the information behind it that is interesting. Let me introduce you to another boat. I don't know if you have it in Indonesia. We have it here in Europe. It's called Sam. Sam is a travel boat. Sam is a travel assistant. Okay. Have you met Sam? It's like, I have a video here. I'll see if I can manage to play it. Otherwise I will explain. So it's an application you can download that is free. And Sam is taking care of everything when you travel. For example, you said to Sam, okay, I'm going to Paris in 2 days. The day before, Sam is going to check the weather. It's going to tell you, be careful. It's a bit cold in Paris and it's raining. Don't forget your umbrella. Then Sam will tell you, that's not working. Then Sam will tell you, let's forget about the videos, okay? And then Sam will tell you when you are about to leave, be careful, there's additional traffic jam to what was expected. Do not take a cab. You'd rather use the train. There is a train leaving in 15 minutes. Shall I book a ticket for you? Yes, Sam, please book a ticket. And Sam is booking the ticket. When you join the airport, Sam will tell you, okay, the terminal for your flight departure is this terminal, and you could go there. When you are about to arrive to Paris, Sam will tell you, you have three options to reach your hotel, the train, the cab, or the bus. Currently, the less expensive is the bus. You can get a ticket at this place. So really, Sam is taking care of everything. Apparently it's working. Connections. Okay, let's move on. So Sam, it works. Sam is actually managing your entire time. For example, this is an application. Sam would tell you, hi, Kate, your flight to home is on time and traffic is looking clear. You have time to relax. Okay, when you are at the airport, Sam will tell you, okay, the door are opening in 5 minutes. It's time for you to go to your gate. Okay, so it's really enhancing a great consumer experience because it makes everything so easy. It makes everything so easy. You don't have to care about the bus, the train tickets, looking at the gate. It's all in your pocket. It's all Sam. Actually, Sam has been awarded like one of the best innovation at the UK fair about the innovation in the travel industry, okay? And it works pretty well. Actually, when it was launched, Sam was naming itself your 24/7 angel. 24/7 angel. Someone who is looking after you all the time. And now they even have new options in it. For example, you are probably aware that in France, we were the victims of some attacks in the last years, okay? So if there will be an attack, you would get a message from Sam telling you, are you safe? Are you okay? If you do not reply to that message, Sam would warn that you are not answering and that you might be at risk somewhere. So you see 24/7 angels. Okay, so if we look at that, we know that artificial intelligence delivers great consumer experience. A new way to interact with Connie, okay? a new way to have someone to look after you, to remind you to take your umbrella. It's like your mom, but forever. And also it enhances cultural diversity because you can travel and using the language you want. And it makes the consumer more satisfied. Some people are uncomfortable to ask at the receptions because they need extra bed sheets. But maybe they would be comfortable to go to Connie and say, can I have an extra bed sheet, please? And Connie would process that information. Okay, so it's really providing new experience, a more complete set of options to the consumer of the industry. But also, it optimizes company's performance. Because while Connie takes care of extra beddings or extra sheets in some rooms, the people who work for the company can focus on things that are more maybe relevant that no artificial intelligence devices can do. So we all fear that robot will replace us. And that's actually questioning does it mean to be human, truly? So what I'm describing here, you might think, oh, it's like a perfect world. You have here, you probably know the picture from Michelangelo in Chapel 16 when you have two hands connected. Well, here's the new one. It's like humans and robot working hand in hand for great consumer experience. Okay, beautiful world, thank you. But what happens? What happens, let me ask you, what happens if Sam makes some mistakes? What happens if Sam provides inaccurate information, sending you to the wrong airport in Paris and you miss your flight? And because you miss your flight back, you could not report to your boss or you lose a very important contract and then you might lose your job. What happens if you ask Connie, oh, I would like to have a great Italian restaurant in Paris, and Connie sends you to a dangerous place? What happens if the artificial intelligence is making a mistake? And I think that's the way we look at it from a philosophical point of view. Who is responsible? Who is in charge? Will you shout at Sam, you may be late for my business meeting and I had trouble? Of course not. Are you going to call Sam to talk to a human and say, I had a problem because of your device? No. And I think that's the main point with technology, making sure that responsibility is still under control. Some people see artificial intelligence like a super smart 5 years old.
Hello, everyone. I think there is a little bit issue on the internet connection, I think, in there. Let me just double check with Ms. Delphin. She should actually be connecting very soon. Apologies for this inconvenience, I'll be with you soon again with Ms. Delphin as well.
Okay, I'm back. Sorry about this. So let me see, where is my computer screens? Ronaldo, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly.
Okay, I'm sorry, everyone. Where did I leave you? Where did it stop? What was the last thing you heard?
We miss you already.
Okay, so what did you hear? Did you hear about the responsibility thing?
Yes, exactly. The responsibility of the technology when we miss the flight and such a big
impact. Exactly. So who is in charge? who is in charge, for example, okay, who is in charge, who is responsible, and that's actually questioning the true, I just want to make sure that you see me. Yeah. Can you see my screen? Yeah, here. Okay. So, who's in charge, who is responsible? So, anytime you have to take a decision that involves technology, make sure you know who's in charge. Make sure you know, make sure you still have the control, and that's the main point. So what exactly is the responsibility? It's not that easy to define, and being actually when you are the cause of something and you are able to either be blamed for it or be credited for it. And all of us as human beings, we know what it means. I am responsible. I am responsible, I take responsibility. And in today's world, that's something that is so important. We, in ethics, witness, in ethics and in sociology, we have witnessed a rise of what we call collective irresponsibility. People step back, oh no, it's not my responsibility. I was not in charge, okay? So responsibility is something that is becoming rare. And when we look at leaders that inspire us, leaders that turns around the world around, or leaders of the industry, we know they take responsibility. They take risk. And if it goes well, okay, they are credited for it. And if there's a mistake, they say, okay, my mistake, I'm taking responsibility. So artificial intelligence is like a super smart 5 years old that can process data, create incredible client's experience, but cannot be responsible. So 2 weeks ago, the World Economic Forum, which is a non-governmental organization looking at the future of the economy globally, worldwide, has released the top 15 skills that will be the most important demanding skills on the market by 2025. Of course, this report takes the pandemic in consideration. And if we look, I'm not gonna read all of them. If we look at the top skills, analytical, thinking, innovation, active learning, problem solving, basically all those skills refer to the ability to be responsible. Being creative means you take responsibility to think outside of the box. You take responsibility for risk by being creative. Critical thinking is your ability to step back, to pause, to think, and to take responsibility on the decisions. Okay. Same with problem solving. Okay. Artificial intelligence can process major data, but they might not be able to find a solution because you need to be responsible to take a decision and to stand for that decision. Same for learning, same for innovation. So I believe that if we all work on our skills as responsible humans, we have a way to make a difference and work in synergy with artificial intelligence. So should we fear for our jobs? Maybe. Maybe there will be lecturers, there are already lecturers that are processed by artificial intelligence that provide contents. But I believe that when I deliver a session, I take responsibility for what I say, and that makes an entire difference from a video. Okay, so work on this as a human, really, because no other robot or artificial intelligence can take responsibility. So let me remind you what Christian Villange said 100 years ago, technology is a useful servant, but a dangerous master. Now, how do we make technology a useful servant? I don't have any magical rules here. I don't have anything all in hands, but it's really a mindset. Technology is my servant. Technology is not my master. I want to share with you a couple of exercises or things I do in class with my students to help them understand, assess, and master technology as a very useful servant. So the first one, as you can see, I ask my students to master the paper plane technology. Believe it or not, some of the students have never folded a paper plane. Okay, so no, that's just a way of brainstorming for business ideas, but I thought it would be cool for you to show a bit of how it looks in our classrooms. Okay, so actually, if we look at technology, technology is fantastic for many reasons, but one of them, to me, that is, I think, incredible, is that technology gives everyone a voice. technology gives everyone a voice with what we use, what we call the social media. Okay, with the social media, each of us can express an opinion. Okay, can express an opinion, can connect, can share, and can take responsibility. Before the area of internet and the social media, the knowledge was distributed like this. It was like a pyramid. People at the top had the knowledge that would diffuse to everyone. Now the knowledge access is horizontal. Anyone can access anything. The true question is, what do you do with it? You want to follow courses online at our school, at Harvard, Cornell, anywhere? You can, because of technology. And then you can speak out for this. You have an expertise, you want to share it. Thanks to social media, you can. So all of us, we have a voice behind our mask, of course, but we all have a voice. So how do we work with that in class? Before we can maybe use the Q&A, can you please list all the social media that you know? Can you please use the question and answer to be able to connect with us and tell us all the social media that you know? Okay. Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, okay, but are there all the social medias that you know? Okay, we have people answering, thank you. Let's see, I can't read the chat. Oh, great, thank you very much for enabling us to type in the chat, that's fantastic. Okay, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Tinder, absolutely. Tinder, all the dating apps are social medias, okay? Instagram, come on, you can do better than that. My students, especially the smart ones, they reach up to about 25 to 30 social medias. So if you don't answer, I'm going to ask Ronaldo, actually. Last time we had a webinar together, he had to do yoga in front of everyone. So Trumbull, well done. WeChat, excellent. WeChat, Weibo, you might also have local social media that are specific to Indonesia. Okay. WeChat, good. So those, the one that you name, are the big ones, the big players. And when we think about social media, we mainly think about them. Well, actually, the galaxy of social media is really huge. I want to present to you a sociological research that has been done by a German company. It's called the Prisma, the Social Prisma. And here you have a mapping of the top social media. So what do we call social media? We call social media any devices, any platform that gives people a voice. So you might wonder, is Alibaba a social media? Well, when you buy something, you can write your opinion about that element. When you are about to buy something on Alibaba or Wish or Amazon or any platform, you read the reviews. So you have a voice when you post a review on those elements. So it's considered the social media. So on this slide here, you see all the social media organized by category. Crowdfunding, messaging, microblogs, expert. You also have hospitality. It's right there at the top. Travel and hospitality, including Airbnb. When you post your opinion about a place in Airbnb, TripAdvisor, booking, it gives people a voice. So that's how large the platform of social media. So when you think of social media, you have 5 or 10 coming to your mind, keep out there. It's just a little window. There's a full galaxy that can actually help you to connect meaningfully with your audience and might be a lot cheaper than Instagram and Facebook, okay? So how we tackle that in class? In class, I ask my students to work. The main learning outcome is this. What is your voice? What do you say with it? How do you make technology your servant by making sure technology can promote your voice? So what is your voice? What do you say with it? So extra project, one of the projects the students have to do in marketing, it's the virtual influencer project. Okay. Most of you follow influencers. If you scroll through your social media, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, you have people who give their opinion and what they say is important to you. Maybe they advocate a product or service. They have a political opinion. Okay. All of these are influencers. There is also a trend of what we call virtual influencers. Those are people who do not exist. Those are people who are processed. They can look fantastic. There is Lil Miquela, very powerful, 2.8 million people following her, powerful voice, Nunuri, and so on. So I asked my students to create a virtual influencer. So that's how it looks. So the rules of the game for the students, the rules of the game for the students is each group is given a target group to reach. For example, people who suffer from diabetes, families, a target group, people over the age of 60, people who like to travel the world. So each group of students is given a target group. And they have to create a virtual influencers and to create content to connect with the target group. And I'm really proud to present to you the first batch of virtual influencers with our students. I actually used dolls, okay, by Mattel, like bit like Barbie, but it can be male or female. It's non-gender dolls, okay? So they can really promote any type of personality or choices with those dolls. So LGBTQ, they can be male, female, both changing, non-gender, and so on. Okay, so the whole age group had their dolls. They really liked it. That was fun in class. And they created little ones like this. And that's what they did in reality. And then that's what it looks like online. Let me introduce you to Hazel. So Hazel is a young girl. She's suffering from diabetes, and that's her first post. So nice picture. You have all the elements. I just took a few quotes out there. However, in 2011, I was hit with some life-changing news, type 2 diabetes. And she starts telling a story. Because the point of those virtual influencers, what is your voice? What do you say with it? They tell stories. They tell impactful stories to connect meaningfully with your audience. Okay, that's another one. Looks really good. Richie Montana, so cool. Actually, Richie Montana has from the beginning settled partnership with brands such as Kenzo. And what was the hotel brand? I think that was the Four Seasons. Okay, so she settled partnership traveling. And then at the end of the experiments of the social media, of the social media posting, she said, I have realized that I want to make something even greater than online. And she wanted to launch a charity business. Okay. So you see, and that's how they start working on what is their voice. Okay. That's another one that I loved, Eva Ritz. Okay. She was a student, a virtual student at Cesar Ritz Colleges. And she's been questioning what is reality. And look at what she wrote. You have it in pink. I never covered up the fact that I'm not a real person. I don't try to hide my imperfection that differ me from real person. So what is actually Everett telling us here is, I know I'm not real. I know I'm a creation. I am a story, but I am honest into what I am. I am an honest, fake person. Okay. So what is your voice here as a student? You promote authenticity using an influencer. Okay. And then that was the first batch with dolls. Then we were hit by the pandemic. So students started working on 3D projects, okay? Creating different influencers using tags and so on, okay? So it's really about demonstrating ownership, talking about meaningful subjects and connect with your audience because technology gives you a voice. Okay, just want to bring a bit of academics in there. I hope I'm not gonna lose you. It's gonna be like 2 minutes, okay? But so to level up, and if you want to impress people you talk to about technology, might want. Habeas corpus is a law, one of the first law that was used in the UK. It was promoted at the 17th century, and it sounds crazy now, but the habeas corpus actually told us You own your body. Your body is yours. This general law, habeas corpus, is still active in many countries, including the UK. So it means that no one can put you in jail without telling you why, without a judgment, because you own your body. So you cannot own the body of someone else. Okay, that's the habeas corpus, generally speaking. And currently, there are people who are doing research. In Geneva, there is a group, non-governmental group working on it, saying that we might actually need to have a habeas corpus for our digital life so that everything we like, everything we post, everything we scroll belongs to us and should not be collected as big data. So there is what we see is that regulation is behind technology trying to protect the people. So we might have in a few years a habeas corpus that is protecting our technological integrity, because when we look at technology, it is middle age. It's still middle age, okay? Most people like me above the age of 40 knew a world without the internet, okay? People who are around your 20s, who listen to me now, you were born with the internet. You are the first generation of what we call digital natives. You were born with the internet, okay? And you know that this is shaping your brain differently, okay? The one who knew the internet, the world without the internet, are what we call digital migrants. You had to adapt to a different environment. So it's really just the beginning of the story. If we look at the evolution of history, we first had writing that made us move from prehistory to history. Then we had printing that enables us to diffuse the knowledge vertically. And we now have internet, cloud, artificial intelligence that gives access to everything, to everyone, okay? So it's really the beginning of this story and of the regulation. I'm reaching the end of my presentation so that we have time to answer questions afterwards, but those are the main points I would like you to remember from today. The number of connected devices is on the rise. So invest in technologies as business owner to understand what is going on. Second, our brains, all of us, our brains are continuously shaped by technology. Okay, continuously shaped by technology. So same for your clients, okay? When it comes to artificial intelligence, always remember who is responsible. Am I giving my responsibility, am I taking responsibility for an artificial intelligence device? Am I okay with it? Technology gives everyone a voice, that's great. Now the question is, what do you say with it? It's like a superpower, what do you have to say? And are we, in terms of regulation, moving into a technological habeas corpus? This is what I personally think. And honestly, all the countries are struggling to try to have regulation around it, but it's on the way. So, remember, if there's one thing you should remember for today, technology is a useful servant, but a dangerous master. Make the most out of it. And thank you very much for your attention. Sorry, but the few hiccups we had. If there's anything you would like to discuss, any questions you want to ask, please use the chat or the question and answer, and I'll be happy to answer them. While, Subhas, I hope I say your name right. Why we all have voices, how we regulate self so we do not cross boundaries and hurt others. Excellent questions. Someone who worked on that more than 2,400 years ago was Mr. Plato, the Greek philosopher, just writing in the chat, Plato, the Greek philosopher. And Plato and Socrates been working together, not on social media, because at that time there wasn't even electricity, but they settled rules for speaking. It's called the three filter rules. Three filter. Filter number one, what you are about to say, is it true? If it's not true, don't say it. Filter number one. Filter number two, what you are going to say, is it good? Is it good? Is it a gossip? Is it just to tell me that this person gained weight? If it's good, say it. If it's not, say it. Number three, is it going to be useful to me to learn that? Yes, then say it. So it's like an old philosopher. I'm also in ethics class, we cover a bit of philosophy. So the Greek philosophers told us that before saying anything, ask yourself, is it true? Is it good? Is it useful? It passes the three filters, post it. It doesn't, you put yourself at risk and you put other people at risk. Okay, thank you. Well, if you like that, don't hesitate to go through Plato and Aristotle, old philosophy. There are a lot of very interesting things for the way we live today, even though they said that more than 2,400 years ago. Okay? Good. Are there other questions? Any other points? Now there's questions in the chat. I'm just closing my presentation now. Can stop sharing. Okay. My chat. Okay. No? Okay. Any other questions? that you might want, or any topic or maybe opinion you can give about what you just heard?
Feel free to drop the question maybe in Indonesian as well, in case you're not comfortable.
Oh yeah, of course.
You know, I'll be more than happy to translate it as well, and we'll be answering the questions. Well,
yeah, and you just heard my French, so you just heard my English, so don't worry about that. And I don't switch on the teacher modes. I'm not grading anyone.
Exactly. But meanwhile, we're waiting for the questions. I think that's definitely an opening, an eye-opening session for me as well. You know, even though, you know, I'm, you know, there is a certain generation gap as well between us, but it's totally agree. I mean, the development of the technology and how it's shaping our, not only our mind, but our physical ability as well, and our, well, including the disease within the human beings, we're gonna have to embrace it. I think in any type of the business, it's definitely going to change the way how a customer think and how customer behaving as well, especially in this hospitality industry, as you say. So,
okay.
Fantastic. Okay, so we have another question in here. Oh. Will there be threat in hospitality where all the hoteliers replace into AI and where the art of hospitality is gone? This is one of the questions that has been, well, I'm pretty sure been asked by a lot of people. Would you like to answer it, Ms. Delphine? Because as we know that hospitality is all about, you know, it's a people business. It's you know, it's involving people, service, as we know currently in this age. It's all about service, and there is a lot of questions from people. Will there be a threat for the professionals themselves in hospitality in regards to the development of the AI, artificial intelligence and technology?
Well, we don't know how AI is gonna strike us, but we know it's gonna strike us. That's global for sure, okay? Intelligence, if I just look at neuroscience, intelligence is very difficult to define, but mainly all scientists agree that intelligence is your ability to adapt to anything, okay? And I believe that business intelligence is your ability to adapt, okay? So what is coming next is either people have take the risk and adapt to what is coming next or not. Of course, if you don't adapt and you have a traditional business, well, even for sanitary reasons, you can't make any money, okay? You can't make any value, okay? So there are things that will be replaced, and I think that's okay. It might sound crazy to you, but a couple of years ago when you were going to an airport, there was someone who was doing the checking for you for everything and everything. Now you do the checking with machines or even up before on your phone. Is that okay? Yes, because doing checking is boring. It's going to be probably the same in the industry, okay? Some, I would say, specific tasks will be replaced, and that's okay because you do not bring value. However, when people travel, when people go to hotels or restaurants, it's not only about, there's something magic in this industry. People look for this magic. This magic can only be provided by the service and by the customer experience, and this is deeply connected. We all remember a trip we took with someone who really took care of us, someone who was so nice at the reception of the hotel, someone at the restaurant that did something very specific from us. So I think that if we focus on delivering fantastic customer experience, even if you use AI, you guarantee the meaning and the sustainability of your business. I see. So I hope that I answered that. Okay, I see. If AI is going to mainly take over the hospitality industry, what do you think us in the hospitality can contribute to? Well, first, focus. I mean, that's the moment we've been, you know, self-audit. Look at yourself, look at your business. What, all list everything that is done, okay? And try to identify for each of them the risk of the replacement, okay? When it comes to booking online, a couple of people still call the hotel, but most of them book online, and that's okay. Okay, you move that in the evolution of the business. So really trying to map the activities that are purely human on which you can bring additional value, because you remember the customer, because of the way you bond, because maybe now your receptionist will have more time. I'm just taking the example of reception, but maybe your staff will have more time to deliver a better customer experience. Let me tell you a story. Do you know the Marriott Hotel? Of course, the brand, the Marriott Hotel. Well, in New York, if I remember well, in New York, they have a specific partnership with the Royal Ballet. No, not the Royal Ballet, because there's no Royal Ballet in New York, with the National Ballet dancing, okay, in New York. Why? Because Marriott is all about the elegance. In the DNA, if the identity of Marriott, it's beauty and elegance. And believe it or not, all the staff of the Marriott New York is invited to take ballet classes so that they move and they behave in a more elegant way, okay? To deliver a better customer experience where beauty and elegance is in every gesture, in everything they do. This is to say that map what you can make a difference, you can improve as a person, as a human, and other tasks, look, because it's also ways to improve your performance. So as an that's for business owners, and as an individual, focus on the things that you can make a difference, that you can take responsibility, okay? Hello, okay, thank you, Jessaline, for that question. Now, Natasha is asking us, hello, I would like to ask about the influencer assignment. Could you please help elaborate deeper? It is a very interesting method to task to give to the students. Oh, Natasha, you are probably a colleague. You're probably teaching, okay? Nice, well, so in the marketing class, we study traditional marketing tools and so on. And when it comes to social media, I found out that the students were really looking at me like, you are a dinosaur. You don't know what you're talking about. And they're true. They're right. You know, it might sound, I never spend more than half an hour a day on social media. That's not my thing, okay? When they spend 2, 3, 4 hours a day on social media. We don't scroll through the same social medias, okay? We have a different practice. And I thought it would be interesting to, instead of delivering a classical lecture, blah, 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 let me tell you about this, I would like them to experience it because they never measure exactly what is social media. So first, they have to do research about the galaxy of social media that I showed you so that they can perceive that the world is bigger than they do. And actually, they're a bit shocked because my students are in their 20s and they find out that they don't use the same social media as people who are 12 or 11 years old. Okay, so there's already a generational gap. When we talk about influencer, I wanted to actually discuss or cover the deep down subject of what is truth. What is the truth? Okay, what is the truth? What's the point? So, because if it happens online, is it true or not? Okay, and that's an interesting question. And students sometimes have weird opinions. So I kind of play with the virtual influencer because I ask them to follow a couple of virtual influencers and then could give them feedback. And when I tell them, well, this person does not exist, they're very shocked. Like, they lied to me. How could? They did not tell me. Well, okay, that's because even if this person doesn't exist, this person has a voice. So for example, Lil Michaela, I'm gonna write it in the chat for everyone. You can follow her on Instagram. Spelling mistake. It's an Michaela with an A. Okay. She has 2.8 million followers. Her voice is so powerful that all the people in the room here, we probably don't add up to 8 million followers, to 2.8 million followers. So when she posts something like Black Lives Matter in the middle of a social crisis in the US, her voice is powerful. So she doesn't exist, but she has a powerful voice. And I wanted the students to be able to understand the differentiation between personality, person, and voices. Because I think that in the trend of the internet, social media creation, there is what we call synthetic realities. What is a synthetic reality? It's something that happens online, but not there. Okay, that is not in our lives, but that happens online. So is it true? Actually, one of my students told me, but when I play video games and I kill people, do I really kill people? No, it's a synthetic reality, but the act of killing is impacting you as a human. Okay, so that was the idea of work on it. So, and I, they did great. They took great ownership first because it's fun. Then they have to post on Instagram. They create a profile. They see how the rise, the followers they have. Oh, it's only a couple of weeks project, but it's really to tell them what you say online is also the image you want to have as a professional and the reputation you want to build. Okay. And work on that. And that's important. Actually, Natasha, I think on my LinkedIn, I have wrote an article about gamification and the use of virtual influencer. Go through it. And if you have any other questions, feel free to reach out afterwards. I'll be happy to discuss that. Okay. Is there another question? Did I answer your question first? Gisaline, Natasha? Okay, let me see the Q&A. Merci beaucoup. Oh, vous êtes francophone. Formidable. Ben, merci à vous. Okay, thank you. Okay, good. Is there anything you would like to, any other subjects that you would like to discuss? Okay. Unless there's something else. Rinaldo, is there something else I should cover that you think,
I think, I believe if there is no more additional questions from the attendees, we have come, I believe, to the last, to the end of the presentation, the virtual session. A little message from the FHTB team that we will be taking a virtual photo shoot. So I think, let me just coordinate a bit with the,
Yeah, of course, no problem. So thank you very much, everyone, for listening. Please stay online because I have no idea what's a virtual photo shoot. So, you know, we're all learning.
That's true.
I said this presentation was not about talking about purely technology, but what you make of it and how this impacts your life and what you want to do. Just want to conclude with the new word that entered the French dictionary last year. It's what we call nomophobia. Nomophobia is the fear of losing your phone, and it's a mental disease that is actually on the rise when it is a phobia that you could not picture your life without your phone, okay? So it's called nomophobia. I'm writing it in the chat, nomophobia. So as a conclusion, technology is impacting the way we think, our brain, also the disease we have, the tenderness with high phones, and the nomophobia, this fear of not having your phone. I'm saying this to all my students, so I'm taking here the opportunity to tell you this also. Be the master of your brain. Lots of people are investing into better understanding how brain function influences and so on. There is only one person who can truly know, and it's yourself. So take care of your brain, okay? Think about it, step back, and that's how you can really make a difference, especially in the times that are coming next. Ronaldo, tell us about this virtual photo shoot.
Great. Exactly, another discovery today, the virtual photo shoot. It's also new for me, but anyways, that's what we have right now. So okay. I will count from one until three according to the instruction from FHTB team. So the photo shoot is going to be start soon. So 1, 2, 3. Jeez. Boom.
All good?
All good. Perfect.
I'm not a supermodel, huh? You know, it's not my generation. So, okay, good, great. Thank you very much, everyone. Take care, stay safe. Greetings from France.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
There's no combination of words I could put on the back of a postcard. No song that I could sing, but I can try for your heart. And our dreams, and they are made out of real things, like a shoebox of photographs with sepia tone loving. Love is the answer, at least for most of the questions in my heart. Like, why are we here and where do we go? And knock on me so hard. It's not always easy, and sometimes life can be deceiving. I'll tell you one thing, it's always better when we're together. It's always better when we're together. Yeah, we'll look at them stars when we're together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. Just might find their way into my dreams tonight, but I know that they'll be gone when the morning light sings or brings new things. For tomorrow night you see that they'll be gone too. Too many things I have to do, but